You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello and welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. As always, I am Ken Reed, your TV Guidance Counselor, and I want to welcome you to one of my favorite shows we've recorded thus far in the year and a half or so that we've been doing the show. If you are tuning in for the first time, welcome. This is a very fun show. My guest this week is Miss Karen Duffy, who you may know better as Duff. When she was a VJ on MTV in the 90s, she's also an actress, as we discuss here. You may know her from Dumb and Dumber, or Blank Check, or any other of the movies she's been in, and a correspondent on TV Nation, which was an excellent show. She's a fantastic writer. After this episode, if you do not already have it, definitely go out and buy her book. It is fantastic. She's got several books, actually, but Model Patient, My Life as an Incurable Wiseass is her first book about her struggles with her illness, and it is incredibly well written, very funny, and she could not have been nicer. She is one of the best people I have ever met and interviewed on this show by far. She was incredibly gracious. I loved talking to Karen. Very, very funny, smart, fun person, and wait till you hear some of the stories in this episode. They are unbelievable, but true. So, as always, sit back, relax, and enjoy, as I know you will, this week's episode with my guest, Karen Duffy.
Spanning the globe to bring you the constant variety of sport, the thrill of victory, and the agony of defeat. The human drama of athletic competition.
Karen Duffy, hello.
Hello. So nice to have you in my office.
Thank you for having me in your office. Mm-hmm. It's a very, very hot day in New York. It's very summertime-like, although it is not summer.
Mm-hmm. I know. We just went right from... It was freezing at our farm in Connecticut. Actually, it was 32 degrees, and
too cold.
It's 90.
Well, it's like going away to the tropics in the middle of the city.
It is. I know. But you're holding up very well, I'll say, Ken.
Well, thank you. It was. I try not to walk around too much, as I often sweat very, very profusely. Mm-hmm. So we were just chatting, and you were talking about how you kind of managed to get on MTV, which was pretty fascinating, not to jump right in. Mm-hmm. But you were saying you were working at a home for the elderly.
At a nursing home, always. I've worked at a nursing home since I was 13.
Okay.
Actually, 12. So I started when I was in seventh grade.
And you grew up in New Jersey?
In New Jersey and New York. My family runs Duffy Sanitation, which is the longest continually operated family business in New York City.
Very nice. So, well, sanitation is the second oldest business in the world.
True.
The first one.
So right across the street from my family's townhouse is a nursing home. And I started volunteering there when I was in seventh grade. And then when I went away to college, I went and studied gerontology, and then got my postgrad degree, and I wound up going back to work at the nursing home that I'd volunteered at since I was a kid.
Right.
And I loved it. And I was saying that my experience working with Alzheimer's patients who have a 2-inch attention span,
right,
I really had to speak clearly. I had to elocute. And I also know how to speak with my hands,
right,
to kind of, and what's interesting too is just, my physiognomy. I have black hair, white skin, and red lips.
Yes.
And to elderly people, they see gray-haired doctors in white lab coats against a white wall.
Right.
So they really can't see who's talking to them.
Right.
So I would just
really
dress.
Stood out.
I stood out so I could get people to pay attention to me.
Right, right.
So I knew all these tricks. And I was like, you know, look at those jackasses on MTV.
This,
I mean, I'm a jackass too. Why shouldn't I do that?
Literally jackasses later.
So I wound up getting, I made a video. And
she just unsolicited sent a video in.
Sent it in. I sent it on a Friday, and it was Memorial Day. And on Tuesday, they said, come on in.
That's insane.
Like, I know. It was, I really didn't have high expectations. I'd been working at the nursing home, but also as a model and doing a ton of commercials.
Right, I'd so you've been doing some stuff.
I'd been in front of the camera, but never hosting.
Right, never as you looking directly into the camera and sort of speaking to the viewer.
Mm-hmm. I essentially had like the one pose that everyone does when they make like what they think is their hot face in the mirror.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, that's essentially what I did. Yeah.
What was the first commercial you, like, what were some of the commercials you did?
Skippy peanut butter.
Oh, okay. Classic. Annette Funicello.
She was, yes. I remember on the set of that peanut butter commercial, I grew up with a lot of people who, are gaffers and best boys. Right. And I remember being on set and this woman, Dee Dee Dolan, who I went to high school with, like a big chip tooth tattoos. Yeah. And she's like, wait a minute. Aren't you one of those Duffy girls that I graduated from Park Ridge High with? I was like, oh, no, you're thinking of my older sister.
Right, right, right.
And I totally lied to her face.
Nice.
But I did about 100 commercials.
Oh, wow.
So I did a ton of commercials.
And they were shooting, so in this was in the mid-80s probably?
Late 80s. Late 80s, early 90s.
And really they were shooting the majority of commercials in New York at the time. Like all the TV production for most shows, aside from like soap operas and some game shows, basically moved to LA in the 60s, late 60s, early 70s. But commercials, soap operas, and the news kind of stayed
in
New York.
And Saturday Night Live.
And Saturday Night Live. And then MTV comes along in 81 and was the biggest thing ever probably in New York at the time. And you were in a really unique place in MTV because you were kind of the first generation of VJs that kind of grew up watching it.
Well, yeah, it was interesting because I went to school in Colorado in the West Coast and MTV wasn't there.
Right.
And I actually, at a nursing home, I couldn't afford.
Right. And it's cable. Not on in the nursing home.
Yeah, it wasn't on in the nursing home. They were watching that. It wasn't until I actually was on the channel that I actually, well, I mean, I was completely aware of it,
right,
and I would watch it at friends' houses,
right,
but I didn't actually get it wired legally into my house where you pay for it.
Right.
And it was interesting that having the experience working with the elderly transferred to working with the audience that also had a 2-inch attention span.
Right. And musicians who often do as well.
True. So there was a challenge, and I would go, and I really wanted to get up to speed because I wanted to be good.
Right.
And so I would go to the Museum of Broadcasting and just watch all the old Frank Sinatra variety specials.
Which probably sounds crazy to people now because essentially now you could just probably plug that into YouTube and see the whole history of everything. We would just physically go to what was essentially a television video library.
Yes.
And sit in a booth and watch these things with headphones on.
And they still had the commercials.
Yeah.
And it was amazing. And I just watched. I was like, okay, like, I was a huge Sinatra fan.
Right.
And
is that because of the New Jersey-New York connection?
That's definitely, and his amazing pipes. But I just really thought, like, he did it so well.
Right.
And one of the things that I noticed was he was always really dressed.
Right.
And was very self-deprecating and really let, when a performer was on, just let them shine.
Right.
And so he always just seemed so gracious. So I kind of internalized that, and this was at really the height of grunge in the 90s.
Right.
But I would always have stockings and high heels on.
Dressed for television.
Be dressed.
Yeah.
And, you know, my esteemed colleagues Karen. There was a woman, Karen.
Was there Carolyn Hedman?
No, it was after Carolyn Hedman. It was Spooky. It was a guy, Steve Isaacs.
Oh, yes. Yep. And Kennedy just started towards
Kennedy,
the tail end
we
of
all
you.
Started. No, we all started together.
At the same time?
Yeah, right on the same time.
Because after you was like John Cencio and like Idalis and Bill Bellamy. That
yes,
was like
yes,
the late
90s. I work with Bill, too. We kind of overlapped. But kind of like right after me, it was Dave Holmes, who's amazing, and Carson.
Yeah.
And then they just blew up.
And then
up.
They don't have VJs anymore.
Yeah, and then it's over.
Yeah.
But it was amazing because years later, I joined the Sinatra Society. At the nursing home, I would have the Frank Sinatra Appreciation Hour.
Okay.
And I would write fan letters to Frank Sinatra. And a friend of mine, actually, who knew Frank Sinatra, said, oh, you know, there's this VJ on MTV, and she's crazy about you, and she talks about you all the time. And I was in the hospital, and a huge, I think it's right there.
Oh, yeah.
8x10 of Frank Sinatra came, and the next day, a big wooden crate, and Frank Sinatra painted me a watercolor.
He painted you a watercolor?
It's amazing.
That's yes. crazy.
I know.
And he was probably in his 80s at that point?
Yes. Well, yeah, he died 90s? At 80. Yeah, in his early 80s in 1998, he died.
Wow.
So this is his 100th year. He was born on December 15th. 1915.
So you're a fan.
Yeah, I'm a fan. Yeah, a little bit of a fan.
Yeah. But there's an interesting thing too about that sort of the people that came up in the you know in the 40s through the 60s who were hosting things on television. They weren't a generation raised on television, so mm-hmm. they still had sort of a showbiz, you know, have to multi-talented kind of thing where you might sing, but you might also have to present a show and you mm-hmm. also have to dance and act and do comedy sketches and all these sorts of variety show things, which is kind of a lost art now because mm-hmm. people specialize so much more or whatever the opposite of specializing is, where they're on TV and can't do anything. and that's very unusual. And I think we're starting to wane probably in the early 90s. So I think that you definitely stood out as a VJ when you would watch you on MTV, which now makes sense. Why?
Because I knew those psychological tricks. Right. And also...
You're probably the only VJ with an advanced degree, I'm guessing.
Well, it was interesting. I was a couple years older than Spooky. Like the other, they were all in like their, I would say like early to mid 20s, and I was in my late 20s. And they were much more casual.
Right.
And I remember like certain VJs almost had like a sense of like, proprietary fandom over
certain genres.
Like they, and I was kind of like, oh, you know,
yeah,
I just felt like, you know, the best thing is to broadcast and not narrowcast,
right?
And kind of be, I mean, it was like when a cheesy band would come on,
right?
I felt like, well, you know what, hooray for them, they made a video and got it on way better than I ever did.
Jesus Jones is doing well.
Jesus Jones or Firehose.
Yeah, they what was their Love of a Lifetime, was that their song?
And
Firehose was good.
Firehose. And also the you know, it was kind of at the end of like the hair band era, and so I would actually do my research because I was used to preparing for my job at the nursing home.
And if you're going to interview someone, you should know something about them.
Yeah, and also I have a unbelievable memory. I have not exactly photographic, but I would say photogenic.
So not quite Mary Lou Henner.
No, actually, my sister and I are like, what the hell is Mary Lou Henner doing? That happens to us all the time.
Right.
Actually, my sister Kate and I are entering the Memory Olympics.
Oh, nice.
And I think one of the reasons that I think my memory is so strong is I always felt that your eyes looked dead if you were just reading a teleprompter.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
And so I could actually just look at a page and almost take a picture of it mentally.
Right.
And then look at the camera and then read what was in my
brain. So you're memorizing copy like that.
Yes. And I would write it myself. I would work with a writer.
Right.
Because I felt like I was so new. And also my colleagues were all really into very specific genres. And I didn't have that.
Right.
So I just approached my job as a fan.
Yeah, and you came across more like the news people, mm-hmm. which is a compliment, you know, where it had a little more gravitas mm-hmm. and did seem more knowledgeable. And that did stand out, you know, like when they'd send you to like spring break or something. It always seemed a little bit like, is she reporting on something bad that happened?
There? I know, I kind of felt like mutton dressed as a lamb a little bit, but it was really great fun. And then I wound up like dating this knucklehead that I am still crazy about. I dated Whit Crane from Ugly Kid Joe.
Oh, yeah.
And we're still unbelievably tight. And
was the Cats in the Cradle era.
Yes,
of Ugly Kid
Joe. And I hate everything about you. But the sad thing was their biggest song was a cover. So they...
That curse hit them.
It was really kind of funny dating this California surfer knucklehead.
Right, because you consider yourself very East Coast.
Yeah, very. Yeah. I mean, I would never love New York. I love where I'm from. And he'd be like, hey, Duff, is like New Hampshire a state? Like,
it's a state of mind.
Have you read a book?
Yeah.
And he's like, no. And I remember one time He was just hilarious. Like, you know, he's and sometimes dating somebody with a drinking problem can be a lot of fun.
That's true. Hindsight, it's often fun.
Yeah, booze hounds can be a lot of fun.
Yeah,
and I remember like one time saying, you know, Whit, you know, you are just such a great guy, and you're so funny, and you know, you always tell me how much you love me when you're hammered. Yeah. Like, you never tell me when you're normal.
Right.
And he's like, well, that's easy. Because normally you're not that cool.
Ah, which and you set yourself up for that one.
Made me love him even more. And I laughed my ass off.
That's better than if you said I love you.
I know. It was even better. He just never let me down. Yeah. He was so consistent in being a knucklehead. And I just adore him. I talk to him at least once a week.
So you're still in touch with a lot of the people that
you met. Yeah, some great friends. I mean, actually very tight with the crew.
Yeah.
With my just today, it's 4 p.m. and I probably spoke to maybe 6 people that I worked with at MTV already today. And that's just a natural part of the day.
Right, right, right.
Jody Morlock, who did hair and makeup. Gina Rossitano, who was the stage manager. My producer, Angela Carbonetti, I spoke to today. Tabitha Soren.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Tab's great. She's doing amazing.
Yeah, she's doing photography now.
She has a big show, which I would highly recommend.
Baseball photographs.
Baseball, yeah, yes. Yeah, yeah. Well really done.
Really great photographer.
Well done, Ken.
Try to land
She's, I would say I'm probably closest to Tabitha.
Yeah, well, she was the news person, too. It would make sense that, like, you had probably similar mentalities, probably felt similar among the rest of the people.
Yeah, I mean, it was just, I think... We became really close actually after we left because our departments weren't really together, but I spent most of the time with the crew, with the technical crew, and it just seemed like that was a little bit of a destabilizing time because I came in, I took over Martha Quinn's shift.
Yeah, so you took over for the original VJ. So this was like this was almost like the second cast of Saturday Night Live. Yeah. It was like all this pressure for these people who sort of invented this format that no one had seen before. Although, side note, we were mentioning your brother was in a Boston band called Rods and Cones, who were very popular in the Boston area because they were on V66, which was the local UHF MTV rival, which is very strange. So, I mean, aside from that local sort of blip, it was MTV was kind of it. And they sort of invented this format.
And also MTV did something great where they had the basement tapes.
Yes.
Where unsigned bands could send in their videos.
Every Saturday night or something and they put them against each other.
And pretty much absolutely every band, you know, had a photo of themselves on railroad tracks.
Yes, railroad tracks were very big. That was the big late 80s photo. Mm-hmm. And like the 90s photo was like in a field.
Yeah.
Or like a flower field was the big 90s. Yeah. Was the railroad tracks, then flowers.
Yeah. There's been a trajectory.
Trajectory of that. And you would, they would have you host, like you would fill in. I think I saw you host MTV Raps once or something.
No, I when I first got hired on MTV, I hosted Fade to Black.
Okay.
Which was an R&B show.
Okay.
And I hosted with Todd One.
Okay.
And Ted Demme, bless him in heaven, was the director. Yeah. And it was funny. I had dinner with Fab Five Freddy last week.
Oh, nice.
And it was just so great to see Fab. Because Fab was the original host of MTV Raps when it was on, like, on Saturday nights.
Right. Like once a week.
Yeah. And then when it became a daily show in about 92.
Yep.
So in between that time, there was a weekly show called Fade to Black.
Okay, that was like hip hop and R&B stuff.
Yes, hip hop and R&B, and it was kind of cool because I got to like interview, Jermaine Jackson.
Right,
this would have been a son named Jermajesty.
Jermajesty, yes, he has a quote when he was on the UK version of Big Brother.
Mm-hmm.
He was telling the other cast members about his kids, and he goes, "My son has a very special name." It was Your Majesty, and they were like, "That is quite the introduction, because that is a very special name."
Yeah, and I know it's. I do collect people who name their children
odd things.
It's a good collection.
Yeah,
I loved. I felt was like that, that kind of was stuff not you my. To?
Wasn't
that
your...
was actually I love like definitely like The Sound of Philadelphia, TSOP. I love. you know, Larry Gamble right. and Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes.
Okay, so classic stuff.
Classic, more yeah. Al Green. Yeah. Actually went to Al Green's church, the Full Gospel Tabernacle oh, wow. Church in Memphis. So I like Barry White
yeah.
and Herb Albert.
Actually, well, he had a song at that time with Diamonds that Janet Jackson sang.
That's
around
right.
the same time you were probably just starting at MTV.
And Herb Albert is unbelievable. He's in his 70s. He's an accomplished artist. He's
yeah.
started A&M Records with, I think, Larry Moss.
Yeah.
And
what a smart guy. He's one of those guys we were talking earlier that kind of get in the industry as a performer and then kind of get how it works.
Truly.
Sort of unlock the business piece of it.
Yes, like, he's a polymath.
Yeah.
And the way he was essentially self-educated and, you know, he was a Russian Jew.
Yeah.
But everyone thinks he's Mexican because
right.
of the Tijuana Brass yeah. playing the horns. But I go to see him every year. And early in the year when George Clooney was getting married,
yep.
George and our old buddies, and...
George comes up often on this show.
He's very funny and has an unbelievable body of work and
oh, yeah.
And what he's doing next in television. I mean, he's taking it to the next level.
Well, he's a guy that was on so many shows for so
yes.
long, and people are always
shocked.
From the
Fats of Life,
and,
yes.
You know, he was on the original ER comedy show,
yes.
and then ER later. And
the
just,
Talking Baby show.
Yeah, Baby Talk, yeah, with yes. Julia Duffy, the first season before mm-hmm. they recast with Scott Baio. The only time Scott Baio replaced George Clooney ever. Yeah, it may happen again at some point. But, you know, it's just been around forever in these things. And it's amazing when you see those people who transitioned from television to be, you know, movie stars and do all these amazing things like that.
Well, it was interesting that we were saying again how you have to really expand your talents, I think,
right.
in order to be a true entertainer. And we talk about that a lot. Like, you know, we're always like, you know, is it Frank Sinatra or Sammy? And George is always like, you know, for sheer talent, Sammy Davis could do everything.
Really?
And so for George's wedding, I convinced Bill Murray and I that we should actually perform.
Okay.
And I have a terrible voice, but I also knew that all I had to do was essentially get Murray to agree.
Yeah.
And
people are going to be looking at him.
He'll be, yeah. he bring out the bread and mustard, the ham is on the stage.
Yeah.
So we rehearsed for about 5 days in.
That's dedication.
In yes. Yeah. No, we really worked hard. It was funny. We were out on our terrace and. It's just amazing, just the fact that I'm, you know, that two of my best friends happen to be icons.
Right,
in,
right.
And
where did you meet them initially?
Well, I met George through his cousin.
Okay.
And I worked with his cousin, and he was like, you know, you would love
right.
my cousin George, and George and I met and have been really, really tight, and... I would go to all these events with him because I'd be his wingman because,
right.
like, you know, I'm not going to jump on his lap when a camera yeah. comes around.
Yeah.
And also, having another chick makes every other woman really competitive. So
okay.
It was a good thing. So I introduced George to Bill, and they became really good friends.
Yeah, they seem to have a similar sort of wise-ass sensibility,
yes.
I imagine.
They're Irish Weisenheimers.
Yeah.
And they did The Fantastic Mr. Fox at
yes.
our farm. They filmed that. They recorded.
Oh, did they really?
Yes, that at our farm.
Oh, I've seen the footage of that then on the DVD.
Yes,
the,
so that's
yeah.
That's our house. And Wes Anderson wanted a place that was a real farm where he could
right.
actually incorporate all the sounds. So it's funny.
Yeah.
So I did all the female voices
oh,
until
yeah.
some ingenue.
Came in and over.
Yeah, Meryl Streep. So
ugh.
It was so funny. Like there's one scene where we're, you know, talking in a rocking chair and they had to like animate a rocking chair because
yeah, yeah.
you could hear that on
the creaking.
So George and Bill became really good friends. And when George was getting married, my husband was the best man. And so Billy and I were rehearsing. So we decided to do a medley of Herb Albert and the Carpenters.
Very nice.
And essentially.
What Carpenter song did
well,
you
we started off with Herb Albert, This Guy's in Love with You.
Okay, appropriate.
And then we went into the Karen Carpenters' Close to You.
Okay, all right.
So it's they still have the horns.
Yeah.
And then
you didn't use the Rick Moranis Parenthood arrangement.
No. We actually Bill arranged it. Bill really? was a musician before he was a comedian and an
actor.
I didn't
know that.
And it's amazing because, again, he looks like he's just flying by the seat of his pants.
Yeah.
But we rehearsed, he arranged.
Right.
And then when we got to Italy, we met with the band and rehearsed. I mean, he
got this down.
Works really like seamlessly to make it look effortless.
Right. Which is the hardest thing to do.
It's so incredible. So the night after, George did a great thing. They had the rehearsal dinner the day after the wedding.
Yeah.
Because they didn't want everyone to be all hungover
right.
at the wedding.
That's smart.
So it was like the wild party after.
Yeah.
And Billy and I went up and I had horns. I bought a bunch of trumpets
okay.
off of eBay.
Yeah.
And
best place to buy mouth instruments.
used.
Yep.
And then, but we had a 3-piece brass section. So we didn't,
nice.
It looked like we were faking it.
Yeah.
And it looked like we were actually playing. And, it was just amazing and one of the best moments of my life.
So did you grow up, I imagine, watching SNL and when
yes.
Bill was on it and stuff? And
yeah, and it's funny because I met Bill at this guy, Michael O'Donoghue.
Yeah, Michael O'Donoghue was the original writer for SNL, was one of the original National Lampoon writers.
Yes.
He's sort of credited with giving SNL the edge when it first started.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so I knew Michael, and Michael died of
a brain hemorrhage.
Probably like around 94, 95.
Yes. And he wrote Scrooged.
Yes, he wrote Scrooged and did another one with Doug. What's the guy's name who wrote Animal House?
Oh, yes, from National Lampoon. Doug...
Kenny.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I met Billy when Michael's wake.
Okay.
And have just been great. We own a baseball team together.
Oh, nice.
A couple of them.
As you do with your friends.
I know. I mean, literally, it costs less to be a shareholder of this baseball team, which is in New England.
Yeah.
We own a team called the Torrington Titans. And
what state is that?
It's in Connecticut.
Oh, Connecticut. Okay.
And the Brockton Rocks.
Oh yeah, the Brockton Rocks.
Yes.
Yeah.
Love the
Brockton's. Weirdly, on this show, I've had guests. The most amount of guests who've been on the show have been from Brockton.
You're kidding.
There's been like 6 people from Brockton on the show.
And that doesn't include Rocky Marciano.
No,
which
Rocky
is the reason
Marciano.
Why they're called the
that
Brockton
is why
Rocks.
The Rocks. Yep. The most amount of boxers have come from Brockton.
And yes. Well, so who is it? Haglin.
Yep.
Haglin was from Brockton.
Yeah. A shoe town
mm-hmm.
that
yes.
fell on hard times and then made boxers.
Yes.
We can't make shoes. We'll make people who fight.
It's pretty, it's been amazing. I feel like it's a Nantucket sleigh ride working on this. It's a wooden bat league.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's been around for, I think this is our 5th season, and we're already outselling the Cape Cod League.
Were you a big sports fan growing
yes.
up?
Okay. I mean, I wanted to be Marge Schott, except
okay.
not a racist.
Did you play
yes.
sports? And
yes.
Stuff? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was played baseball and skied, taught skiing. I really do more independent sports
right,
rather than
right.
team sports.
Not team sports. Would you come into the city a lot and go to games? Or?
Yes, I live for the Mets.
Okay.
And I just love that baseball doesn't have a clock and
yeah.
it just unfolds. And so Bill is the commissioner of fun for our league. It's
okay.
called the Futures
That's
Collegiate
important.
Baseball League. And I'm actually going to go to the Vineyard. It's
okay.
opening weekend, June 4th.
Okay.
Next weekend. And for Father's Day, Bill wanted to give out a free vasectomy.
Excellent.
And Father's Day, but the Catholic Church has shut us down.
They would shut that
yeah.
down. They're very touchy, no pun intended, about vasectomies.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why or what it is, especially in the New England area.
I know, especially with Catholics.
Yeah, it's
so
very, very strange.
It was, but it's been really great fun to come up with cockamamie ideas.
Yeah, and you have the means to sort of make these things happen, which
yeah,
is crazy.
And it's also, like, it's essentially, it's a non-profit. We're just doing it
yeah.
just to have fun.
It's just
and,
fun.
You know, our tickets are $5 each.
Which to me is so, I mean, I grew up in Boston, which has become a ridiculous sports town where it's I just don't see it how it's fun anymore, mm-hmm. the way that, because people are just so serious about it, and it's not a game. It's mm-hmm. a thing. And so when I see the sort of minor league teams, I'm like, oh, you know, if it was like this, I would go all the time. Like, it would seem more fun.
Yeah. I love how, you know, every time, you know, in between innings, there's always some sort of entertainment.
Right.
Our goal with this unbelievable group of the board of directors and the players, they're all college athletes hoping to go into the major leagues.
Right.
Like Steve Strasburg, you know, the pitcher who won the World Series,
yep, yep.
He came up through Torrington, Connecticut.
Okay.
So it's funny, like, you can live in Torrington, Connecticut, you know, where it's a very kind of depressed mill town.
Right.
You know, as
makes
you're being
the
scouted.
Best athletes.
Yeah. Or you could wind up playing for the Martha's Vineyard Sharks,
right.
and living in some swanky billionaire's
right.
Guest house. But it's really fun, and I love the humor of it, and
yeah.
just
it's more it's sort of probably more like what going to games was like when you were growing up.
Yes,
as opposed
exactly.
to now, where it's, I don't know, it just seems more like a bar where people.
Yeah, true,
like a,
true.
Like a college bar or something.
Yeah, and like what's up with like food? Like
oh, it's ridiculous.
It's insane.
Yeah, I can't, when I was growing up, well, first of all, for the Red Sox, the Rat, which you mentioned mm-hmm. earlier, was the punk rock club. And that was across the street from Fenway Park, and they rented out their parking lot to people going to games. So inevitably, when the game got out, it was just a huge fight
mm-hmm.
While people, like drunk people, came back. But I used to go to Celtics games all the time because it was after they had won championships and they didn't have any players anyone cared about. And you could just walk in.
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't check tickets, and
wow.
you just walk in. And it was a lot more fun. You know, there wasn't like these ridiculous food prices. They weren't getting lobsters
yeah.
and all this stuff. And so it was like, this is just kind of fun to hang out. You know, it's not like, it's going to cost me $400.
It's
know?
True. Like, yeah. I went to the Rangers with my son. My son's a goalie, and I love hockey. And we wound up in these amazing seats. And they're like, oh, there's a buffet. I'm like, it looked like a wedding. But like,
yeah.
like at the hockey game, there was more food than at like my wedding.
You're like, how long is this game going to be? Why do we
like,
need to?
Yeah, there was yeah. a sushi bar, and there was like lobsters. And it's just like, I remember going, when I used to go to Ranger games with my Uncle Freddie, he would eat peanuts with the shells on.
Yeah.
Because he's like, I miss too much hockey peeling them.
And okay, I don't like, want to look down.
Yeah, exactly. It's
the original
so
stadium buddy.
And the stadium pal.
Yeah.
And, it's just funny that, you know, now there's a...
Well, it's like, you know what's ruining this 5-star restaurant? No sporting event going on yeah. at it. I think if we could somehow incorporate that. So you did Rock and Jock as well, didn't
yes,
you?
Yes,
I the
was,
first one, speaking of that.
Yes. My friend Mitch Kozachowski, who I speak to all the time, he was the producer and the... he was actually the technical director, but a great, great guy. And I think I was doing sideline reporting, and Anna Nicole Smith was the bat girl.
Yes, yeah.
And one of the things I wanted to do with this baseball league is actually revive the Rock and Jock.
Oh, MTV?
You know, have it at one of our...
Oh, one of your events.
At one of our events, yeah. And
that'd be great.
I think that'd be great fun.
Because I think that stuff sort of fell by the wayside, because as if we were in this sort of transitional period at MTV when they started doing these more original programming, and the thing that literally changed the world, the real world, started in probably the same year that you started on the
yes.
network. And that literally changed the world. It invented the reality show format that... everywhere has.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're seeing things like that, MTV Sports and Rock and Jock and The Big Picture, and it's sort of becoming more of like a lifestyle branding thing.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my favorite shows was House of Style.
Yes.
Really, which...
Oh, I know. Cindy's the one person that I'm probably closest to.
Okay. Did you know any of the people from that show first from the modeling world?
I knew so. Well, Cindy, Cindy and I lived near each other. We were neighbors in the West Village, and then when she House of Style was done through the news department.
Okay.
Because
it started as a series of specials before.
It started
it was a
specials,
weekly show.
And actually, Cindy wasn't the first host. It was I think different hosts, and then Cindy.
Yeah, they had different people on each special. Yeah, I'm trying to think of who hosted the first one. I can't remember.
But it's funny because Cindy is. Like, really a great girl, and we go away every year, and we're going in June, this big group of us, and already I'm getting emails like, all right, you know, there's a specific set of problems as a middle-aged woman that, like, when your best friend is Cindy Crawford and you're going away with your family, it's like, what do you wear?
That would be, I think that would be just not even for middle-aged women, just for everybody just for who's not Cindy Crawford.
Well, I've said it's not really what we're wearing. It's what Cindy's going to wear.
Right.
So we ordered her a burkini.
Nice.
Which is a full burqa swimsuit.
Excellent. Perfect.
And my friend was complaining that you could still see her eyes, and she's got very pretty eyes.
Problem.
Sunglasses.
Did you see her episode of that show, Who Do You Think You Are, that she did?
Oh, is it, of course, family? Like she's like some queen.
She's like a Mayflower, like something from royalty. It was really, she actually went to New England, and it was very interesting.
Cindy actually is very, very bright, very quiet. Like,
For a Midwestern, she seems.
Yes, like very low-key. And her husband, Randy's great. At the wedding, I kept teasing George, like, don't sit me at the loser table.
Right, right.
There was no loser table possible.
There is no loser table at George Clooney's wedding. It's not possible. I got invited to a wedding on Block Island that was my uncle's, and they put me at a table with everyone he forgot to put at a table.
Oh, yeah.
It was like people they invite, like, used to work with, they invited, didn't think would come. They're like, how do you know? And I'm like, it's my uncle. And they're like, why are you sitting here?
Yeah, so you kind of you got the loser table.
So you requested no loser table.
So I was sitting next to Cindy, and Cindy and George, Cindy's husband Randy and George own a tequila company.
Okay.
And all the money that George makes with this tequila company, Casa Amigos, goes directly to the Enough Project.
Okay.
And the satellite Sentinel, which they buy time on a satellite to monitor the border of North and South Sudan.
Wow.
So every time you do a shot, you are doing something for a great NGO.
You're not getting that with Sammy Hagar's Cabo Wabo.
Yeah, exactly. You're just getting cirrhosis.
You're just
that.
Getting cirrhosis and probably embarrassment to hide the bottles when you throw them away. So you're growing up in New York and you're watching, you know, Saturday Night Live, but like, what were the shows that really resonated with you? How many kids were in your family? It's
four.
Okay. So a small Irish Catholic family.
Yes.
And you were in the middle or?
Yeah. I'm the second eldest.
Okay. So you probably had a little bit of sway on the TV, but it was more of a negotiation.
It was always sports. I mean, I loved ABC Wild World of Sports.
Okay. I mean, they had weird stuff on that.
Yes. I mean, I love that memory in our family. My parents were going out and they would like, Barry White would be on the record player. There'd be scented candles.
They're setting the mood.
The lights would go down and we'd have a fire. And I just loved watching like the highlight reels, especially like the sports highlight reels that they would marry to pop music.
Right, right.
Which know, like all the
proto
great
MTV stuff.
Yeah, like all the great fumbles to like Frank Sinatra's That's Life. Right. And so I loved that. I really love like the very nostalgic ABC after school specials.
Yes.
Like my sister Kate and I will, you know, we'll watch them together.
What's
on
your
YouTube.
Favorite one?
Stoned
is the big one.
I like that one. I really like The House Without a Christmas Tree.
Yes. So you like the holiday specials a little bit more.
And that's just so sad.
Yeah.
Like Jason Robards is such a dick.
Oh, yeah. Jason Robards is one of those guys that I always like watching, but he seems just like a sad old jerk in everything that
he's done. He's
even
always
Something Wicked This Way Comes might be my favorite thing he's ever done, but he's like amazing in Magnolia.
Yes.
Sort of playing
yes.
There's one called My Father Lives in a Downtown Hotel.
Okay, I just saw that. Yes, I know. Was that a Jason Robards vehicle as well?
I think so, yeah. We were talking about Stone Pillow earlier, the Lucille Ball one. Yeah, I think that a generation has missed these sort of scare films. I don't know how effective they were. I also really loved Angel Dusted with Helen Hunt.
Yes.
Crashing through a window.
Yeah, that was great.
Would you watch those sort of with a sense of irony growing up? Or?
Yeah, well, I come from a big family, a long line of Weisenheimers, and like to show any emotion, you were immediately pummeled.
Oh, yeah.
So you had to like have this like this very thick undercoating that they cover battleships with,
right.
So barnacles don't. Like before you'd watch anything, like you couldn't get a lump in your throat, or
right. You have to make fun of it to sort of counteract. This is stupid.
Yeah, yeah. They make it sound like Lord of the Flies, but.
Yeah.
It was like that. And I like my sister and I love like Blackula and Let's Kill Uncle.
Did
great
you ever go to
music.
The old 42nd Street when you were growing up?
Yeah, I mean, all the time.
Happening?
When I was 15, when I was in high school, I would come in every Wednesday for, I would go to the theater all the time.
And see those exploitation movies?
Well, no, I'd go to the Broadway. Okay. I'd go to the shows. Yeah. But like, I remember going to see American Buffalo with Al Pacino.
Okay, yeah,
and
yeah.
The father from the Waltons,
yes,
was Ralph White.
Yes, yes.
Was actually sitting next to me, and then he went outside to smoke a cigarette. And it was just like interesting living. I grew up 13 miles from New York City, right. So very close. And
so did you get kind of, not blasé, but was it difficult to be starstruck because you were sort of running?
No, I actually remember the first time going to MTV. And when I was going to do actually my screen test,
yep,
and I
on
walked,
the Tuesday after you mailed
on
them
that Tuesday after, and I walked in, and Colin Quinn,
yep,
was
he
there
doing remote control at the time.
Remote control, and he was so funny, and he was like, "Oh, look at this woman! I wonder what she's doing." And it happened to be there was a book that they were doing called 24 Hours in America.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so I actually happened to, like, walk in and at the moment when they were taking a photo at MTV. Before.
Perfect timing.
And I remember being somewhat struck. I'm friendly with Colin, and he's still... I'm still starstruck by him because he is a massive talent.
Oh, yeah. And had you seen him do stand-up or know of his
yes,
stuff before
and,
then?
Yes, and, I mean, I've actually seen his... He's done amazing shows.
Oh, yeah, the one that Seinfeld directed.
Yes, and the one, Sanctifying Grace,
yep,
which was a beautiful...
another SNL alum as well.
Yes, I know. He's so great. And then it was... so I was somewhat kind of starstruck seeing like the presenters,
right,
but not necessarily with the musicians because they were all so new,
right, so they didn't have that sort of
but it was just like
gravitas.
Yeah, but I had the admiration because they were there,
right,
and
right,
you know, they'd made something that I didn't, and I always felt like my brother would always say, oh, some of those VJs act like they wrote, directed, and starred in those videos,
right.
And so I always felt like, you know, I'm never gonna have that. I never felt that way, but I never wanted to come across in anything other than like
check
no matter
really
what.
Cool thing out
you,
that
you
someone
did
else
it.
Did.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah, yeah, you did it. Although I did get in trouble with a Mariah Carey. I was like, every once in a while, an amazing voice comes together in a story with a video, and it just knocks it out of the park. But until that happens,
yes,
here's Mariah.
That
Mariah
video
Carey
is Rush Rush with Paula Abdul and Keanu Reeves.
The one where she dances with the animated cat.
Oh, yes. Two steps forward, two steps back.
You're so
I just
good.
I thought it was weird because she was like, opposites attract. I'm like, you're saying the opposite of you is an animated cat? That's very strange.
I know. It's just the songs don't have to make sense.
No, absolutely not. In fact, the less sense they make, the more people enjoy them. I was like, when Mariah Carey first came out, she for years it was like, she was a backup singer for Brenda K. Starr. And now people be like, who is Brenda K. Starr?
And that you could, would only shoot her on one side of her face.
Yes, yes.
I was in a lot of videos as a video vixen before.
Before you were a VJ?
Before a VJ, yes.
Which videos were you in?
I think a New Kids on the Block.
Oh, which video? They fascinate me.
Yes, a lot of hip-hop videos.
Okay.
I think Heavy D, Special K.
Oh, like Now That We Found Love.
Yes. Keith Sweat.
Did you ever have to introduce a video that you were in?
No, they never were. At that point, no.
They were out of the rotation?
They were out of rotation. And I don't think I would have actually... If that happened, I don't think I actually ever... cop to it.
Yeah, yeah. I think that would have been weird, or if anyone called you, I'm just like, that's not me. I don't know what that is.
Cheryl Pepsi Riley. I did a bunch of them. I did a lot of videos. And then I was dating Dwight Yoakam, that country singer.
Yep.
And I was in, like, I was like, yeah, I can't be in one of your videos.
Right, right. It's
just
too much. It's too, yeah.
It's just, you know, it is... You are so, like, such a masterful musician.
Right.
Like, you don't want me tainting this in any way.
So with your ability to memorize stuff, and clearly you're naturally inclined to be a performer, you've done some acting stuff, but that didn't seem like the path that was that interesting.
Oh, have you ever seen anything I'm in? I mean,
I have a few things.
It looks like I've got Dutch. I could have Dutch Elm disease. I am absolutely... So wooden. I mean,
did you just freeze up, or
yeah, I'm very comfortable being myself.
Yeah, yeah.
And
you were always like a great talk show guest. Like, you seem like a person they wouldn't pre-interview. Like, yeah, you seem like that kind of.
They always pre-interview you. But the great thing is if you get somebody who listens, like David right. Letterman, who listens and you could play with. But actually, it was, I did a movie. I think it was called 29th Street. And it was like my first big role where
did
I played.
Did you get that through modeling or had you auditioned to be an actor?
I had auditioned. I read for it for the director and I wound up getting this part and I was in LA and I was driving back from the studio because I did do some looping and I was like, what is it about that movie? I was like, I know, that's the worst movie I ever saw in my life.
It's terrible.
I better get a new job before I'm box office poison. So I knew that movie was going to be coming out in like November.
Right.
And I was like, okay, what's in New York?
Okay, a very small window.
Yeah, yeah, okay. I've got to get something now before anybody sees this movie and sees how terrible I am. So there was like soap operas, but then again.
That's a totally different, like I think that's such a specific group of people that can do that kind
of
thing.
Yeah, plus I don't have the mug for it. Like, but I was like, no. And Saturday Night Live, I was like, MTV. That's why I sent in the video to MTV.
It's smart. That's a very good process of elimination sort of.
Yeah, well, I wanted to see what was available. Yeah, there's game shows, and I wasn't going to be a game. There was no female game show hosts. So I really, I knew that I wanted to have a new job before this came out.
Right.
And of course, the movie came and went, and nobody ever noticed. Yeah. But
you
I knew.
You hedged a bet, though.
Yeah, but I knew it was horrible. The funny thing is that when Dumb and Dumber, when I read the script for Dumb and Dumber, I had grown more comfortable in front of the camera.
Yeah.
And when I read it, it was originally called A Power Tool Is Not a Toy.
Excellent.
And it was going to be an $800,000 movie, a very small movie. And so as soon as I read it, it was so funny on the page that I called the writer and just was like, this is hilarious.
Yeah.
And I happened to be in LA and I met Peter Farrelly and we became great friends.
Another
and
New
I was
Englander.
Like, I will, yeah, that's another from Rhode Island. I was like, I will just ask everybody. So I asked like all my actor buddies to do this. And like I was dating Chris Farley at the time and I couldn't get anybody to do it.
Yeah.
And originally I was going to play the main role of Mary.
The Lauren Holly role.
And then Jim Carrey came out with Ace Ventura Pet Detective, which blew up.
Yeah, and that was a small movie that nobody thought was going to...
Exactly.
It had an animated series. It was so popular.
He's so he wound up signing on, and then he wanted...
Lauren.
Lauren was much
they were
more...
Dating or something.
I think they were courting. Definitely, she was more his type physically.
Yeah, okay, I see.
So I was like, I'll do craft services. Like,
right. I just
want to
so be
glad
there.
It's And so it was very sweet. They were like, well, you've been such a good sport about it. Listen, we'll give you like a percentage point.
Oh, nice.
And
nothing will come of it.
And that's exactly. I was like, you don't have to do this.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just over the moon. So they gave me literally a role of a man, one of the bad guys,
with
Mike Starr.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I wound up. Having a ball, and I was filming TV Nation at the same time, but it was so great. And then who would have thought that it?
Yeah, I mean
up.
That movie is just like all their movies are such huge cult hit. Like they're the quote movies that
but
like
they
people
were,
bond over the quoting of their movies.
I know, but Peter and his brother Bobby were really struggling. They were selling round beach towels in Venice. So it was really just so fantastic that they wound up. Success couldn't have happened to a better group of guys.
And they're guys that, like, when you hear them talk about their movies, every role is someone they know.
Yes.
Like, every person in the background, they're like, I grew up with him. He's a guy I went to camp with. Like, they just stack the movies with everyone they know.
True. It's like,
Which is such a great indicator.
But they always have hockey players.
Yep. Or former Red Sox.
Yes, they Roger always they have like because they want the people that they want to meet.
Yeah, yeah.
And Bill Murray's always in them.
Yep.
And
as well, he should be.
Bill Murray's
movies.
In the second one in
Dumb and Dumber.
Dumb and Dumber.
I still have
two.
Not seen that.
Oh.
Okay.
It's pretty funny because I was at his house and I said, "Oh, I was just for Dumb and Dumber 2, I still owned a point. Right, so I had and then, which was amazing, MTV hired me back 20 years later.
Did
go,
you ever think that?
No, I had no idea. You know, I'm like, you know, my 52 and I was going back to MTV and it was amazing.
What was it like walking back in there? Did it
Well, I did it on location.
Okay.
And it was so similar. We had a conversation. I was always pretty much fairly self-contained.
Right.
Because I could write every, you know.
Right. You're approaching it more like a news story.
Yeah. So I knew how to, so no producer came.
Right.
And I went on set. And it was just amazing because, you know, I was on MTV when I filmed the first one.
Right.
And
I was booking.
I was back. And 20 years ago for the first Dumb and Dumber, Jim Carrey, who is exactly the way he is on in real life. He's just funny and charming and just will go for the laugh. And he is so sweet and really thoughtful and I would say very philosophical.
Right.
But he kept falling down and, like, and grabbing his stomach and everybody thought he was joking. And I'm a trained community emergency response team. And I was like, are you okay? And he's like, no. But nobody would believe him.
Right.
So the meat wagon comes and I was like, where does it hurt? And I was like, if it's here, it could be your either your appendix if it's low, but it's by your cojones, or it's, and it was his gallbladder.
Oh.
So I was like,
you have gallstones?
And I said, when they take out your gallstones, will you give them to me?
Okay.
So as they're wheeling him in, he's like, save my gallstones for Duff. So then I went back to see him in the hospital. And actually, this was kind of cute. Lauren Holly was dressed up as like a total sexy nurse.
Oh,
like,
very nice.
Like really slutty, sexy nurse. And he had a huge screen TV and he was watching his operation. He's an interesting guy.
Okay.
And I was like, all right, fork over the
gallstones.
And actually, I have it. I had it set. And
in a ring or something?
Yeah,
or
it's an appendant.
Oh, very
nice. I'll show it. And I wore it to when I interviewed Jim. And I was like, does this look familiar?
this was inside you.
You are a human oyster.
Wow.
And it looked like malachite.
Oh, very weird.
Yeah, he had three. And so one big one, and then he gave one to Lauren.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I was going to make her earrings, but
but she ruined that plan.
Yeah. It didn't last long, though.
So you're collecting pieces of celebrities.
I thought it would be good to open up a museum of celebrity used parts.
Yeah, people would go to that.
Yeah.
I mean, they would happily go to that. I think that would be more what people would want to see than anything else.
You know, when I was on TV Nation, we did a story about the National Endowment for the Arts.
Yes, and having their funding removed.
Yes, and the NEA and NEH. And the American taxpayer spends about, of all their tax bill,
it's like 70 cents a year. Or
80
something.
Cents.
Yeah.
But we spend, as a country, more money on military marching bands than we do on actually publicly funded art.
Yeah, which is crazy.
So it was really a fun story to kind of tell the story of what would the art landscape be in America if we only had privately funded.
Right.
So I went to like Coke World and I went to Kentucky Fried Chicken Museum.
And all the military museums.
Yes,
right?
The Museum of Chemical Warfare. And
fun for the whole family.
It was funny, but I really got into it, like the beer can museum.
Oh, yeah.
And then I was like, we actually, because some of those museums, like some of the things we're finding, it's like, okay, we had to like essentially make parameters. And it was like, would you rather want to see a pig drive a car or go watch Angels in America?
Right.
And I was so wanting to go
these two things?
The pig driving the car. So we couldn't actually show the really funny like museums. We had to kind of keep it.
Because it's like a 3-minute story.
Yeah.
So TV Nation is a show that I really loved. And it, I think it was a summer replacement series on Fox.
Yes, it was. Yes.
Probably.
Yes.
And it was Michael Moore. It was right after he had done Roger and Me.
Mm-hmm.
And it was essentially like a proto Daily Show for people that don't know. And you had Louis Theroux was the first thing I ever saw him on.
Mm-hmm.
Gene Garofalo. And it was a fantastic show.
It was amazing. It was, it was a summer replacement show, and I...
And on Fox, of all things.
I know. It was amazing.
A very left-leaning show talking about corporate greed so much.
It was some of the things that we did. I actually got that job by writing letters. The same way that I sent in a videotape to MTV, I wrote a letter to Michael Moore when I heard that he was doing a show.
Okay.
And I wrote a letter to the head of NBC, which is, I think maybe... Warren Littlefield, the head of Sony TriStar. And I'm like, congratulations, this guy's a talent.
Right.
You know, you I wish him. You all the best. This is a show. And I wasn't lazy. I didn't just write the same note to three people. And apparently Michael said that he was in a meeting and they're like, oh, we got this note. And three people opened up and showed that they got these letters.
Right,
they're like, this person must really want a job.
She's very enthusiastic about this.
So I met Michael Moore at the Howard Johnson's in Times Square.
Nice.
And
rest
I've
in
actually
peace, Howard Johnson's.
Been on every show that he...
Because The Awful Truth
created,
was
the awful
Bravo
truth.
After that. I
yes.
Think. Yep.
But the first season was so crazy. We created something called TV Nation Day.
Okay.
Where we actually hired a lobbyist and had...
Yes, I remember this.
We had August 18th announced as TV Nation Day, and I had to go to a hospital, and the first baby born
was the TV Nation baby.
And
he's probably 20 now.
Yeah, I know. It's so crazy.
Yeah, let's hunt down the TV Nation
and,
baby.
And you know, we gave him a salami from Katz's Deli and like a club and all these crazy things. And it was... So crazy. Then we closed down. We actually got all of the in Fishkill, New York. It became TV Nation Day, and that was where they closed the banks and we closed
the bank holiday.
Yes, and we had a parade, and it was so out there. It was
but it
really
made really
great.
Interesting points though too, and I think that like the one of the segments I'm pretty sure you did the segment that sticks with me is when. There were people buying AIDS patients.
Yes,
life
the viaticals. Yeah,
that is one of the craziest things I've ever heard in my life. And you're able to present a thing like that, which is horrifying,
mm-hmm.
but in a funny way. Which...
And also, I thought, you know, I am a devout Catholic. I'm a hospice chaplain. I'm a trained chaplain, and the word viatical, the viatical insurance, is where. I have a life insurance policy, and it's for, say, $500,000.
Right.
You, as an investor, can give me $300,000 and take it right there.
It's like a bail bondsman. Almost.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then you can take your mother, like, you know, and it was mainly AIDS patients.
Yep.
And I remember interviewing the guy, and he's like, listen, the great thing is there's no cure. So, I mean, you can't go wrong. And I was like, well, you can really go wrong morally. And it was funny. I was just talking to a buddy of mine, and I remember I had to ask some really tough questions.
Right, because that was one of the more serious stories.
Really serious. And it was also, I had to ask questions that I was not comfortable. And so I would actually write the question on a cake. So I would actually, because I had to get the question out.
Yeah.
So I would go to a bakery in whatever town we were, and I would be like, okay, how do you morally justify this? And then I just give him the cake.
Hand them the cake?
And he'd have to read it and tell me.
Oh, it's a shame that that part isn't in the segment.
I think there's a shot of the cake.
Yeah, because everyone likes cake.
Everyone likes cake. Yeah. And also, people usually need, you know, something to kind of fire them up in the afternoon.
Right.
But, you know, it was interesting. The people, viatical comes from the viaticum, which is the communion that during the Crusades, the priest would give to the crusaders fighting to dominate Christianity all over the world. So I thought that that was kind of an interesting history. And one of the things that I learned was, like, they were like, listen, we can go into cancer.
Right.
We can go into, you know, ALS and all these,
heart
like, just
problems.
Think of all
yeah.
of these.
It's a growing things. Business.
It is a growing business. And he was just saying, like, you know, and there's no cure on the horizon. So you really, and I said, well, how do you know? And he said, it's, well, you know, because this was before the world was wired.
Right.
So the way, so say you own my life insurance policy.
Right.
And you've given me $350,000. And you're going to make
You're happy. You get cash. What's the problem?
So the way I did it is the person had to send you a postcard every month.
Like someone being held for ransom.
Yes. So you got essentially a note that was all the company would give you, a stack.
Not dead yet.
Yes. Essentially, and then your job was once a month to put that in the post. And then you would get it. And then when you didn't get a postcard for a few months.
Cash it in.
That's when you would cash in.
It's so weird to me that some of that stuff seems so fringy and crazy then that I feel like the world has grown into that kind of stuff more. And it seems more okay to do that kind of thing now.
Yeah, I loved when we did a thing where we had love night for hate groups.
Yes.
So we had like the gay men's choir go sing to all of the people who hated them the most.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And we would have like, Baptist choir singing to the Ku Klux Klan. And we just really found hate groups. And it's funny, I'm very, very close to everybody on that show. Michael, because it was so extraordinary and so brave.
What you guys got away with on that show was amazing. This is a primetime network show that has a very, very clear point of view and a message. And are presenting these stories that wouldn't even get covered on a mainstream news program.
Mm-hmm.
And it's mostly being watched in the summer by kids or teenagers because they're off school. Yes. And they're watching so much more TV.
He was on it Friday night.
Yeah, and it definitely made an impact, I think, with people who see that kind of thing. Because television, when you stumble on these things and you get that spoonful of sugar that helps a message get through, is one of the most powerful tools there is for things. And especially where people didn't have the internet to go, let me see if that's true, or let me find something that counteracts that so I can make myself feel better.
Yes, and yes.
That sort of thing.
I've just wrote my latest book.
This is the third book?
This is my...
You did the cookbook?
And then the memoir. So this is a book called How to Live in Chronic Pain Without Turning into a Chronic Pain in the Ass.
Oh, very nice.
But I also have another book, The Hockey Mom's Guide to Life. But I didn't... I'm going to publish the pain one and then the hockey one.
Okay.
I didn't want to flip them over, but my editor is somebody who I worked with at TV Nation, two people. And it was so much fun because, it was essentially a race because we had to get the satellite. We had to get the tape to NBC. And sometimes it would be like within like a minute because Michael was always tweaking and, I remember, so that was the Summer Replacement Series, and we were nominated and won Best Information Series. We won the Emmy, and it was incredible, and we got canceled the next day.
Yeah.
And then...
Obviously.
I think NBC picked us up and then canceled us. Yeah. I think we went... and then eventually the BBC and the Canadian Broadcasting funded it, and then it kind of went to the Awful Truth.
Right.
But it's funny because when we were working on TV Nation, I had a beach house with some people from MTV and some people from TV Nation. And my buddy was dating
the crossover.
Liz Winstead.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And
Daily Show creator Liz Winstead.
So when we were all working on TV Nation, she was developing The Daily Show. And John Stewart, who actually he was the one who gave me all the gummy jobs.
And he was doing a ton of stuff on MTV at that time.
Yeah, he had a great show called You Wrote It, You Watch It,
which is what The State came out of.
Yes.
They would, I actually wrote a story into You Wrote It,
You Watch
It.
Oh, you did?
Said, yes, about finding a dead body in my neighborhood.
Wow.
But I loved that show, and he had the John Stewart show, and he was doing a lot of stuff on House of Style as well, weirdly.
That's right, and I was the first guest on every single one of John's shows.
Yes, because he had the syndicated show that replaced Arsenio Hall later,
yes,
which was a great show. And I loved his MTV show. It was fantastic.
He is, again, so immensely likable.
Yeah. And he had Howard Feller, announcer Howard Feller.
I know. He's such a nut, right? It's funny, the same team that we all worked with at MTV have been working with John for 20 years. So
it's amazing.
Such loyalty.
Everything you've said about how being in touch with still and working with these people still, it's really the exception rather than the rule. And it's interesting how you've stuck with all these people for so long.
Yeah, and they stuck with me.
Well, it's true, yeah.
And when George was getting married, he you know, and he has a beautiful sister, and it's very difficult, I think, to be George Clooney's sister.
I would imagine.
Your mother, George's mom, is Miss Kentucky.
Yeah.
And his father was, you know, this newscaster.
Was Rosemary Clooney his aunt?
His aunt, yes. Yeah. So George's sister, who's a private citizen, I just thought, oh gosh, it must...
Civilian.
We're going to, like, let's, like... We've got to buy some dresses because yeah. I just imagined, like, I was just getting the monkey squirts thinking about, like, what I'm going to have to wear. And I'm right. like, yeah, and nobody cares
about
Cindy
me. Cindy Crawford wasn't coming. Oh, no, she was coming.
Yes, that's, I know.
Yeah.
So I wanted George's sister to feel beautiful and comfortable because this was a lot of pressure. Right. Her life was changing as well. And I also wanted her to get makeup and hair. But I also didn't want her to feel judged in any way. And so I mentioned this to John and to my Jody. And then, like, without a beat, come and use my studio. And it was just so beautiful that John Stewart opened up his hair and makeup so I could help this middle-aged woman who is from Kentucky that's never had her hair done, never had her makeup done. And not only that, like, they bought her everything in the makeup kit. Like, just good people. Like,
which seems rare. Like, that's amazing. And these seem less like people that you worked with and more like people that you, like, went to college with or something. Like, you seem
maybe
to have
I
that
feel
more.
That's true because we were all starting out and on a level playing field. We were all kind of rookies. And
sort of inventing this stuff as well. I mean, all the sorts of genres were basically new. I mean, you were only the second generation of MTV VJs. These sort of comedic news programs hadn't really been done. I mean, pieces of them had been some SNL, you know, but this was all new. And so you didn't have the expectations, I guess, of what was going into it. So that probably makes you feel closer to these people because you're sort of inventing this.
True. And also, I think what I've noticed, and as you're saying this, Ken, it's a, like, if you don't give up, you'll eventually get there. And I just saw, like, how this group of people that I really admired, the funniest, most thoughtful group, like, still just so generous.
Yeah.
And, you know, 20 plus years together. But they are so inspiring to me. And I think their generosity has truly been like a beacon.
It's amazing to see good people get rewarded.
Yeah.
Because I think so much in the world now, especially the entertainment industry, just like sociopathic jerks will seem to like keep doing well. And you're like, oh, God, there's no hope for people who are actually decent human beings. But there is. And it's nice to see that. And, and that they don't change as people. Like they have more means to help more people.
Yes.
You know, like the tequila with Clooney and,
and
you know, Jon Stewart doing it. And it's amazing that
they
do
this. Jon Stewart has, like, I think one of, I think the principles that we all share is that if you do something, like, for someone else, if you talk about it, it doesn't count.
Right.
And I
Because then you're not doing it.
And so it's just, I'm a great devotee of Epictetus, who is the father of Stoic philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
And the Stoics believe that we can't control what happens to us. We can only control how we respond.
Right.
And that's just been, I think, truly guiding my morality is just the fact that I can't control what's going to happen, but I can control how I'm going to react to it and how I can respond and how I can maybe do this with grace.
Which is very interesting for someone raised Catholic. It's a very different.
Yeah. It's I think, you know, you take faith where you can find it.
Yes, absolutely.
But I see, that morality and that generosity and that humility. It's funny. I find I'm not really invested in social media and it's so immodest.
Yeah.
And I think if I just wanted to read boasts, I could just read my journal. Yeah. Like if I went to hear bragging and boast. But so I don't do a tremendous amount of social media. And what I see with my friends like Jon Stewart and people who have really at the pinnacle, like you couldn't get any better than what John or what George were doing. It's funny because I grew up with Jimmy Gandolfini.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We went to junior high and high school together, and I remember my yearbook. He wrote, Duff, I'll see you on Broadway. And I'm thinking, unless they build a new Broadway in the middle of Park Ridge, New Jersey, I won't be seeing you anywhere.
Just about the street or the actual Broadway?
I know. Yeah. And it was very interesting because, again, Jimmy was a great guy and success in no way changed him.
Yeah.
But he never enjoyed it. Like,
right.
I would say he enjoyed it in his own way, which was a very grouchy, not grouchy, but like...
Like begrudgingly, like I'm missing out on a part of my life because I have to...
No, I think he loved what he did, but he was very shy.
So he didn't like the things that came with it.
Yes. He loved doing it.
Right.
And again, he was a guy that would literally give everybody on the set an envelope.
Yeah.
And there'd be a lot of zeros.
Yeah.
And he, again, was a one-man conga line of generosity.
Well, there are those people who go, look, I have enough.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, true.
It's rare, but there are some people who are like...
And I feel like, you know, they're really trying to... I think there is a sense of gratitude. When you're making me kind of reflect on the people that I've kind of come up with.
Right.
And I kind of... when I was really... I just signed like a 3-movie deal at... Disney, and I got really sick, and I just think, well, thank God for sarcoidosis, because it saved the world from a bunch Disney of crappy movies. three more Disney movies.
Toys 2 and 3.
Oh, no, I mean, no, the Disney movies I did were like, so, they're, I would not watch them if they were screening on my own corneas.
Were they Disney Channel movies?
No, they were Disney, like,
Disney movies.
Blank Check.
Oh, Blank Check, yes. I remember Blank Check.
Horrible, nothing made sense. So I kind of, for a couple of years, stopped working.
Right.
But actually kept working on TV Nation and
Awful Truth. You were still on.
And Awful Truth and Revlon, but really couldn't. I couldn't pass a physical.
Right.
So I couldn't
get insurance.
Mm-mm. So I couldn't. Well, I couldn't be insured to be a part of a show.
Right.
So if you know, I had. The way that they pay farmers not to farm.
Right.
I would make these deals to do a TV show, right. Like to do a talk show. And I just could never fulfill it because I couldn't pass that. So that was kind of interesting because I really spent more time writing.
And that's when you wrote the first book. Right?
Wrote the first book and then wrote the second book. And I write for the Times and I had a weekly column in the New York Daily News.
Which is a lot better than making Blank Check.
Yeah, that's true. I do love being alone and writing and thinking and just like just
today. You're completely
in
control.
Yeah, I was like, okay, you were in my apartment and my son and I were coming up from school and I looked at him and as he exited on the third floor, he was like, old people. and he was just like, I have no sense of smell. He's like, this apartment smells like old people.
I didn't notice that.
Well, there's a lot of old people.
Okay.
So then I looked up, why do old people smell?
Right.
And this is kind of interesting.
Maybe that's... No. Have you always never had no sense of smell?
I lost it through chemo.
Oh, okay. Because I was going to say, maybe that's why it was easier for you to work
in the nursing home.
The
it does come in handy. Yeah. It definitely comes in handy as a hospice chaplain.
Yeah, absolutely.
So old people smell kicks in. And what it is, it's called nonial odor, and it's essentially an off gas because as you age, you become less moisturized.
Right.
So you're essentially turning into human jerky.
Yeah.
So nonial odor, but the weird thing is it kicks in at 40.
That's not that old.
So essentially, Jennifer Lopez has been smelling like an old lady for 7 years.
That's if you look when her branded perfume came out.
Yeah, that's probably.
It's the same year, so it makes perfect sense.
And Benedict Cumberbatch is like 11 months away from smelling like an old person.
So smell him now before it's too late.
Before it's
he
too
needs
late.
To bottle that stuff.
Yeah.
Do you ever watch the things that the people that you came up with are in? Like, did you watch The Sopranos? Did you watch
The
Daily Show?
Yes.
Is it hard to get into them?
No. Oh, well, actually, I worked at HBO when I had a deal at MTV and they for a long time.
Yep.
And the guys at MTV, I mean, I just felt like as much as I loved it, it was really skewing way younger.
Yeah.
And it just, I just didn't fit.
That's when tweens were kind of invented towards the tail end of that. Yeah.
And I was like, come on, I'm 8 years away from smelling like an old person.
I couldn't believe how long Kurt Loder hung on there.
Talk about really smelling like a, he had this like senior statesman.
Right.
So when I got the offer to do TV Nation, the big cheeses at MTV were more than happy to wish me well and wish me luck. And actually, I'm still great friends with them. I mean, I just saw Tom Freston at dinner. So I left to do TV Nation, and then I got hired for HBO, and I was with HBO for about 15 years. So I did all of the red carpet and all the interior stuff. But I loved The Sopranos, and you know, it was just funny because, you know, I did all the like musicals with Jimmy. I was a cheerleader. Like Jimmy was like never want Jimmy would never want to do any press.
Yeah.
And I was like, Gandolfini, I have pictures of you in my cheerleading uniform.
Yeah.
So we can do this the hard way.
He's the guy that I always wish did more comedies. Like, he's so great in, in The Loop.
Yes.
Amazing in that movie.
I know.
And he seemed like, he would get cast as the heavy, but he was really funny.
He was really funny. And in our high school, he was voted best looking, and I was voted class clown.
Oh, nice.
Which goes to show you that I went to one ugly high school.
Mine might have had you beat.
Where'd you go to high school?
Melrose High School in Melrose, Massachusetts.
And that is a Boston suburb?
Yeah, it's about 7 miles north of Boston. So, and I hung out in the city all the time and didn't really hang out with the high school today. I thought I was like, knew all about crazy city things, which I did not. I pretty much only knew stuff I learned from movies.
Which, so do you still live in
I weirdly live like a mile from where I grew up. I lived in London for a long time. I met my wife there. We worked at Cartoon Network together. Mm-hmm. And then...
oh, really? Yeah. Did you work with... Dorena, she was the head of Cartoon Network.
Probably,
in London.
Yeah.
She's a Kiwi.
Yes. We did.
She's back here working for Yahoo.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
In New York. Oh, yes, I did. I met her before. Yeah, because TCM was in there and CNN and all that stuff. This was in the 2002. And we moved back to Boston, and then we lived in Somerville, which is like the Brooklyn of Boston, for about 10 years. And we're looking to get a house, and I was like, I'm never moving back to where I grew up. And I'm like, we're a mile and a half from where I grew up, which is very, very strange.
Actually, that is not, because statistically, people wind up actually moving within 10 miles of where they grew up.
I guess you stay where you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, you never moved to L.A. because you like New York so much?
My family grew up on Perry Street.
Yeah.
I moved 5 blocks.
Yeah, so it's probably true for just about everybody. Yeah, and I moved almost as far away as I could to London. And then I'm like, and then we're back a mile and a half. Perfect.
That's great.
So to wrap up, is there anything that you watch now? Like, are there things that you can't miss or things that you watch as a family?
Yes, it is so deeply shameful.
The reality shows?
Yes. And one of
the spawn of the real world?
The Real Housewives is... I have a friend on it, and... my little boy, I was Carol Radziwill on The Real Housewives of New York, and when she just started, I would you know, go with her, and my little boy was like, listen, you're not going on that show.
Do not go on the show.
If you do, don't come home.
Yeah. Like, he was... Well, it's good to have that grounding.
Yeah. So I love, I don't know why, but maybe because American Family was... so big in like 1971.
Yeah. Which is a PBS series. People forget, it was sort of the first reality series.
Yes.
And it was that agonizing episode where the son came out as gay to the family.
Lance Loud.
Yeah. Very, very interesting show. And there's a great Albert Brooks parody movie, Real Life, of that.
Yes. And then HBO did dramatic. They did a movie about
the
Louds. And so I do like The Real Housewives. My son and I, like, it's funny. Like, I've never seen an episode of The Wire or
Breaking Bad
or Mad Men. No, never. But show me a midget renovating his bathroom, and I'm all over it.
Oh, yeah. My wife and I watch This Old House every week, and we'll literally turn to each other and go, we just spent 10 minutes literally watching a guy hammer nails. Nothing else happened. A guy just hammered nails. What are we doing? We're like, I don't know why we're watching this.
Yeah. It was funny. I was out with some girls last night, and we were saying, Debbie Mazar, who's a friend, she's got a great show called Younger.
Yes. Yeah.
And it's very kind of... It's smart and cheeky, and Debbie's awesome, and it's a really interesting idea of a 40-plus-year-old woman who can't get a job because she smells like an old person.
Right. That's
and then she dresses up as a 26-year-old.
Right.
And it's really smart, so I like that.
And Debbie did a lot of stuff on MTV, too. She did a lot of stuff with VH1. I think she co-hosted like some stuff with RuPaul.
And, yes. Yeah, Debbie is amazing. I was actually with her the night she met her husband.
Oh, nice.
She was Madonna's makeup artist.
Yes, she started as a makeup artist.
And she'd be great on your podcast. She's incredible. Love to talk to
her. She had a cooking show, too.
Her cooking show is fantastic.
Yeah.
Extra Virgin. So I like that show. I watch tons of sports. Live for...
Some things stay the same.
Yeah, still live for the Rangers. And...
are there any shows from your youth that you felt you had to introduce your son to?
Like everyone I know. Yeah, the little kid. Okay, so when my son was born, I loved The Little Rascals.
Okay.
And I have the box set of every Little Rascals.
So you were probably watching those on PIX or something.
Yes, with Officer Joel Bolton.
Yep.
And so I would watch them show them to my son, and we would just kill ourselves laughing. And what was really interesting, as he was just starting to talk, he actually picked up lingo from the Little Rascals.
That's dangerous.
So he'd be like, say, sister, let's hot-foot it out of here.
Why is your son talking like a 1940s gangster? Like he's hiding out. No, I swear, I'm a kid.
It was really funny.
That's fantastic. Are you a Dick Tracy villain?
Yeah, it was really funny because he... totally picked up these mannerisms just for a short time, but I wish it lasted forever. But I do like to show him things like Zoom. I think I have like a bunch. I've got every Zoom book
produced in Boston at WGBH.
I know. My sister, every year when I go out for the Golden Globes, I usually do all the red carpet interviews for HBO, and I would bring my sister Kate, and I'd have the makeup artist come and do my hair and makeup. Yep. And I was like, oh, can you just do my sister while she's here?
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, well, can you just give me your pass and then you can go home? And I just said to my sister, pretend you're my makeup artist.
Right.
And I gave her like a powder puff. And Kate like lost her mind. She's on the red carpet and just taking pictures of everybody and like not doing her job. But my producer was just like, I love this makeup artist. Like, she's like,
she's unorthodox. She's like, playing by her own rules.
She's really funny and charming. And my sister has red hair and freckles. We don't look anything alike. And then like we went out to all these parties, and my sister's like, you know, has got a Soul Train dance line with Will Ferrell, and everybody loves Kate.
Yeah.
So they're like, oh my gosh, where did you find this makeup artist? And I said, well, actually, she's my sister. I let the makeup artist go about 12 hours ago. And the guys at MTV, my wonderful production crew, they ever since then have put Kate on the call sheet, and they fly her in.
That's fantastic.
And because she's so much fun. So Kate and I, we have this tradition when we go to LA, we go to the Museum of Broadcasting.
Yep.
And we watch like the stuff that we're 11 months. We're 15 months apart. My brother and I are 11 months apart.
Almost Irish twins.
Yes. So almost Irish triplets. Yeah. So Kate and I would go and, we'd go to the museum and we'd watch like all old, you know, Zoom and after school specials. And we go every year, and the docent at the, Museum of Broadcasting, he's like, it's our anniversary, you were here like last year,
I've pulled all the things for you.
Yeah, it's amazing. And he's like, you know, I've got the original, like the original commercials in my garage. And all of a sudden, like, Kate and I are ready to like follow this guy.
Show them to us, we want to see those funny face drink mix commercials.
Remember, I know, it's funny, my friend Julianne Moore, the name of her book is freckle-faced strawberry.
Yeah, yeah.
Which was funny face.
Yeah, which was huge. It was a rival to Kool-Aid.
Yes, the Kool-Aid rival.
The Kool-Aid rival. That's they won that war.
Yes, but they come did. Back. But I remember that because there was a really racist one too.
Oh yeah, it was
Chinese cherry.
Yes. Well, there was also the Lemonheads. They had Cherry Clan.
Yeah.
Horrific. Now they're just cherry heads.
I do. I show my son old commercials. And I like found like a really racist Jell-O commercial.
There's many.
And he was like, "Oh my gosh! Like this is so not okay. They're making fun of Asian people as if it's all like so insane. It's like
good fun.
It's like Mickey Rooney in
Breakfast at Tiffany's.
It's like it makes that look."
It's crazy. I think that's amazing that you show your son that, because I think context is lost in the world today. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to see some of that stuff. You're like, okay, this for the time was okay. But still, Mickey Rooney, you're like, nah, this was not ever okay.
Yeah.
This is just wrong. Do you ever show him any commercials that you did?
Yes. And actually, I don't really think it.
He's not interested.
No. Or like he really has no, like... He's in fifth grade now, and like Dumb and Dumber is on a lot, a lot of his friends recognize me from that or from some of the Disney movies. So I'd show him, because it's funny, because like a lot of our friends are like essentially cause riots, like when.
Yeah, there's a paparazzi factor going
and,
on. Yeah.
Not with me, but with my friends and. So I think it's been interesting. We went on set to see George do a new movie that Jodie Foster was directing.
Oh, wow.
And you know, and he just sees what a pain in the ass everything.
Yeah.
And I was like, do you have any interest?
He sees behind the curtain and it looks like work.
And he's like, yeah, I'm playing a hockey lady.
Yeah,
like it's interesting that it just doesn't turn his head at all.
Right. Do you think it ever will if he said, I want to be an actor or whatever?
No, he did a few voices for the Fantastic Mr. Fox when he was little. But no, I think he's really confident in his belief that this is not for him.
Yeah. The magic's kind of gone because it's like, seems like being a carpenter or something.
Yeah. Yeah. It's kind of interesting. I think he's had an interesting life getting a window to this and seeing our friends who are so beloved.
Right.
And he just is like, why does everyone know them?
He knows them in a very different way.
Yeah.
Which is interesting. And I imagine some of those things that those people are unavoidable if you live in America in this world. So it'd be weird to be flipping through the channels and be like, why is my mom's friend on the TV? Like, this is very strange.
Yeah, no, like, they'll be here. And it's kind of interesting. Yeah. But
very odd perspective.
Yeah, it's been great. Well, I really enjoyed spending this time with you.
Thank
and
you
I
so
love
much
your.
For sure.
I was checking out your podcast.
Oh,
and
thank
I love
you.
It. And
thank you.
I'm going to tell all my friends to come on.
Thank you so much. That would be amazing.
You
I'd
are
love
fantastic
to speak to them.
At this.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
From a very practiced expert. That means a lot.
Well, enjoy your jerky.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for you are a very good TV guidance counselor.
Thank you. There you go. That's Karen Duffy, a.k.a. Duff. That was one of the best episodes that I've recorded, I think, and I had a ton of fun, and I cannot thank her enough for taking the time to talk to me. Again, buy her books, read her writing. She's written for all kinds of things and is a great writer, and I always enjoy reading things she writes, as will you. And if you like the show, please rate and review the show. It's a huge help. Helps get the word out there to people about the show. And if you have any questions or comments or anything like that, feel free to email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at ken@icanread.com. Go to our Facebook page, just search TV Guidance Counselor, or you can tweet to us at TV Guidance on Twitter. And I love hearing from you guys. I always try to get guests that you request. I try to answer your questions when I can, based on my somewhat unlimited knowledge of television. I don't know everything, but I will try to find out. And I just, again, like hearing what you guys think of the show and hearing that you guys listen. It means quite a bit. So as always, I thank you. And as always, we will see you again. Can I say as always more often in this episode? I possibly could. In fact, I just said it again. But Wednesday, we'll see you again for a brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
Songs don't have to make sense. But show me a midget renovating his bathroom, and oh, yeah. I'm all over it.